Hi guys, what is going on? Welcome back to another drone video. Today I'll be walking you through the best settings for the Air 3S. I'm gonna show you how to get the max quality out of this drone. And on top of that, we're also going to look at movement, so you get those smooth, stable cinematic shots as well. And some of you have probably heard that you get more dynamic range when you're putting the drone into auto and shooting in auto mode. This is true, but it is a little more complicated than just putting your drone into auto and shooting. So I'm going to show you some tips and tricks on how to actually expose with this drone as well. So with that said, let's dive in. Okay, let's start with the video settings and work our way forward. First, we have to go from auto to pro mode to start adjusting our settings. So first up is white balance. Now I highly advise you to set the white balance to manual, because if you have it on auto, the temperature will change mid-shot and this will ruin your footage. A super simple and effective way to set your temperature if you don't know how to do it is to have your white balance first on auto, then let your white balance adjust and then turn it back off again. Alright, next up we're gonna set our resolution to max, which is 4K, to get the absolute best quality that we can. Now for the frame rates, you will often hear a lot of people claiming that you should shoot in 24 or 25 frames per second for cinematic shots, but I have found that shooting with those frame rates causes the drone footage to stutter or lag a bit. Therefore, I advise you to shoot in 30 frames per second to get rid of that stuttering. Alright, next up is color profile. If you just want to capture shots without having to deal with color grading, then keep this on normal. But if you want the absolute most out of your footage and to get the true potential out of this drone, you need to shoot in D-Log M and learn a little bit of color grading. This is the true magic that really separates the visuals from other drone pilots. Now, it can seem overwhelming at first, but don't worry, I have a full video covering this if you want to get into it. Now, also make sure you enable color display assist as well when shooting in D-Log M. That way you can actually see the colors that you're capturing on your display instead of the flat gray image. Now, if you want to shoot vertical video, you want to set it to 2.7K vertical mode, as this uses the full height of the sensor versus cropping later in post. Alright, so next up we have exposure. Now first we're gonna set our shutter speed, and we're going to stick to something called the 180 degree shutter rule so that we get a natural motion blur for our footage. And in order to achieve this, we need to set our shutter speed to double the frame rates. So because we are shooting in 30 frames per second, our shutter speed needs to be set to 1 over 60. Now for the ISO, you want to keep this as slow as possible to get the cleanest image, because as soon as you increase the ISO, you will introduce more and more noise to your footage, and we want to try and avoid this as best as we can. So when you're shooting with these settings, you will often find your footage to be way overexposed during daytime. This is where sunglasses comes into play, or in other words, ND filters. If you got the Fly More combo, there should be 3 filters with different strengths on them included. And these are essential for drone flying, as it lets us get the correct exposure without messing up our preferred settings. And you want to put on the ND filter that brings the exposure meter down to the right as close to zero as possible. Now, the exposure meter itself can sometimes be a bit misleading depending on the scene, so to make sure we get the absolute right exposure, we need to head into the menu, open the camera section, and then scroll down and enable overexposure warning. This will give you zebra stripes in the sky. Now just lower the exposure until the sky is clear of the zebra stripes to avoid blowing out the highlights. Also make sure color assist is turned off when you're checking this, as this can mislead you as well. Now some of you have probably heard that you get more dynamic range when you're shooting in auto mode. This is most noticeable in high contrast scenes like sunrise or sunsets, but the big downside to this is that the exposure will change throughout the shot and ruin your footage. But there is a workaround for this, and that is to lock our exposure. You can do this by tapping the screen. This will bring up a yellow box, and then tap and hold that box to lock the exposure. But before you lock it, I advise you to expose correctly, as I showed you earlier, for the scene you're shooting in manual mode using the proper ND filter, then switch to auto and lock it. That way you get both the correct settings and the full dynamic range from auto mode without the settings drifting away. Alright, so let's get you the best quality slow motion. So if we head into the slow motion section, here you can see that you can shoot either in 4K 120 frames per second or 1080p 240 frames per second for extreme slow motion. Now I strongly recommend sticking to 4K 120, as the quality is much better than the 240 frames per second, and it's usually more than enough for great slow motion. Alright, so quickly touching on photography as well. Here you can shoot a regular JPEG if you do not want to edit, but for maximum image quality, you need to shoot in RAW as this gives you the most information to work with in post-production. Now you can also shoot RAW plus JPEG to have both options available. I also recommend shooting with 50 megapixels as this gives you more room to crop into the photo in post with minimal quality loss. And for the aspect ratio, use 16:9 for wide photos like Facebook covers. But if you plan to post vertically on social media, I advise you to use the 4:3 aspect ratio because this gives you a larger vertical field of view. Alright, so let's turn on some features. The first thing I advise you to turn on is the grid right below the exposure warning for better framing. This is a great composition tool often used in cinematography to help you stick to something called the rule of thirds. Try placing your subject along the lines or intersections for a more balanced professional look. Next up is sharpness. Now I like reducing this to -2 for a more filmic, less digital look. You can still add sharpness in post later if you want to. Alright, so next up we're heading into the most important section of today, which is movement. First, we're gonna look at Cine mode. This is where we want full control over slow, steady movement, so make sure Cine is selected. And first up is max angular velocity. This will adjust how fast the drone rotates left or right. I recommend setting this to around 20 degrees a second for a more controlled cinematic movement. Next up is yaw smoothness. This settings helps soften your rotations, easing into and out of pans smoothly. I recommend keeping this somewhere around 20. Now the brake sensitivity controls how quickly the drone comes to a stop after you let go of the stick, so set this to around 100 for a more graceful stop instead of a jarring brake. Now for the expo settings, these settings change how sensitive the sticks are. So lower values make your movement smoother and more gradual. Higher value makes the drone react too suddenly, which looks jerky. So I always keep my expo values extremely low for maximum control. Okay, next up we have max control speed for the gimbal tilt. This is also extremely important. This limits how fast your gimbal tilts up and down. I keep this at 10 degrees a second to avoid those fast aggressive tilts. Next to that we have tilt smoothness. This determines how gently the gimbal stops tilting after you let go of the wheel. I like to max this out to get that smooth glide in and glide out effect, because you do not want your camera to slam to a stop mid-shot. Now for normal mode, I kinda like everything as they are at default. The only thing I would change is tilt smoothness and gimbal tilt to the same value as in cine mode. And the same goes for sports mode. I don't really capture cinematic shots in sports mode, so I leave everything there at default as well. So basically with this setup, the way I do it is that I shoot in cine mode when I'm flying close to stuff and I want really stable, smooth cinematic shots. And when I'm further away from the subject or higher up in the air, or if I want more energy into a shot, that is when I swap over to normal mode. Now keep in mind that these are the settings that I use and I prefer, so I highly advise you to go out and play around with this yourself, but you can use my settings of course as a good starting point. Alright guys, if you found this video helpful, please drop a comment below, and if you want more Air 3S or drone content in general, I would appreciate it if you could smash that like and subscribe button. Thank you so much for watching, fly safe, and I'll see you guys in my next video.